This case, significant number of the BRICS, notably including Brazil, were associated in the reflection that led to the strategy. So I will be very short, starting with the need for a green growth strategy. That's usually the most easy part. Everybody's convinced in most circles that we have to go the green way, thinking in terms of depletion of natural resources, thinking of biodiversity in this country, thinking of water scarcity that is becoming increasingly a problem. We can anticipate, we are currently forecasting that with the business as usual conditions, 1 billion more people will be subject to water scarcity by 2030, which is in developing countries, which is twice the number as we have today. We have all these long-term problems, and in a way, bad news, but it's also a good news, these long-term problems are manifesting themselves already through the markets. Prices for food are high, prices for energy are high, and that's a direct call for action that policymakers, that public opinions are receiving. We cannot postpone the action thinking that the problem will come at once by in 20 or 50 years' time. They are here already and they are biting already through market prices. So in this context, the green growth strategy that the OECD has been developing is about, has as an aim to propose a number of policy instruments that will preserve growth, economic growth, job creation, while also preserving the environment, reducing the depletion of natural resources and maintaining all the services that we receive from the environment, be they economic services or direct services in terms of happiness and so on and so forth. So what are the policy instruments that we are proposing in this strategy? I will mention mainly two of them. There are others, but these ones are the two pillars. One is prices. Having prices right. I mean, probably humankind has not invented a more effective economic machinery than markets that allow to incentivize a number of behaviors, that elicit the behaviors that will correspond to the prices that are selected, that are formed on markets. The bad news with the environment is that markets really don't go to the right prices. Markets do not take into account most of the environmental effects of our actions, production, consumption, investment, and so on. They don't integrate what economists call negative externalities, the indirect consequences of what we do in terms of carbon emissions, for instance. So if we want to preserve or to put at work in the context of a green growth the effectiveness of markets, the first thing for governments to do is to put the prices right. And that can be done by a direct, well-known instrument, which is taxes. That's used already, that has been used for long in a number of countries in terms of taxing fuels, but that has to be extended into a kind of carbon tax that we are recommending that would go beyond all the, beyond the fuel, the fuel taxes that we know today. So taxes, but also removing subsidies. There are per year around $500 billion that are spent by governments in a number of countries, notably oil-producing countries, in order to subsidize fuel. That's not very good policy. From an environmental perspective, from a social perspective, it's not necessarily, it's not the poorest, I mean, who buy fuel and who have car. So that's the kind of policy that is also costly in terms of economic growth, because the money that you are spending for subsidizing fuel, you have to take it from somewhere, and you are depriving yourself of opportunity to spend it in more efficient ways in terms of growth. So removing this kind of subsidies is also a priority for a number of countries. Then innovation. So innovation is the second policy instrument that we are pushing forward. The prices can be effective in the short term, but in the long term, you need more than that. As I mentioned yesterday, I think we have this number that the cost of mitigation of climate change worldwide would be equivalent to 4% of GDP by 2020, with business as usual conditions. If we innovate sufficiently in the meantime, this cost could be reduced by a factor of 2, from 4% to 2% of GDP worldwide, which might seem a low number. What is 2%? But it is huge. It is huge. And it will be accumulated over time. So innovation is the way to go, which then it makes sense to have this presentation here. And what are the conditions for innovation to develop as it is expected for contributing to green growth? We've identified a number of them that won't surprise you a lot as you've been here for more than one day and have heard a lot already about what can be done for boosting, for enhancing innovation. But there are some specific aspects in this green world that I will put emphasis on. First condition for incentivizing innovation is having the prices right. I mean, when you subsidize fuel, or when you don't have taxes on fuel and all carbon emission activities, you would not expect customers to buy products which are more efficient from this perspective, as they will have to pay a higher price, and that will translate into no saving otherwise. And if customers don't buy these products, well, firms won't invest in them. They won't do research for developing this product. If you look at the technical change in the car industry over the past 30 to 40 years, it's clear. You needed at some point the price of oil to reach $100 and $150 for customers to start changing behavior, and then companies starting to invest not in ways of having cars that can be driven faster, but cars that are saving fuel. So the price mechanism can be extremely effective, but it's certainly not enough, as there are a number of other market failures that work in innovation. So there is a need for public investment in R&D, public investment in all types of innovation. And there we could see by looking at the, let's say, how knowledge is aggregated in order to produce innovations, we could see that two targeted programs are not necessarily the most effective ones. If you put all your R&D in the green world, you will in the green field, then you will quite fast deplete your knowledge resources. I mean, the sources of knowledge that result in green innovations are much broader. It's physics, it's chemistry, it's material science, and so on. So it's needed, at least at worldwide level, that investment is done also in these basic fields. Demand-side policies are also quite fashionable. Again, as I mentioned yesterday, I think beware not distorting competition. Government should buy green stuff, electric buses and whatever, and that will trigger a downstream investment in research, or upstream investment in research, sorry. And what is needed also is stability in policies. You should not claim that you are 100% green one day and put billions, and the day after, well, nothing has happened, and you switch policy, you're not green anymore. The same thing as for innovation. You need continuity in your policy. That might be not as spectacular as the alternative, but if you want companies to invest in R&D, they don't invest just because there is a kind of fashion at some point. They need some stability. If you edict strict standards for environmental, for emissions, particle emissions, for instance, one day you change them the day before, you switch back to them the day after, and so on, companies won't invest in that. It's not conditioned that would justify investment. It's far too risky. And finally, I will say one word on international technology transfer, notably from developed to developing countries. As you know, that has been a key component of the discussions in Copenhagen. In this way, what we could see is that the key factors for such technology transfer to happen are the ability of the recipient country to absorb the knowledge that is transferred, that had been repeated here yesterday, and I could only repeat it now. Absorptive capacity, darkly. You need IPR that will induce, that will make the investors from abroad will be trustful, and you need a number of complementary mechanisms. The CDM, the Clean Development Mechanism of the Kyoto Protocol, is one, although it seems that it has not been that effective. There is reflection today of putting together kind of patent pools and other kind of collaborative mechanisms. And I will stop there, just telling you that although this was a frugal presentation, I mean, I dropped everything that was not absolutely essential to keep it short. One of the things that I dropped is the PowerPoint. You might have noticed that. But there is a set of 35 slides that, if you ask, I can pass you. Thank you.
Bueno, muchísimas gracias. Sí, ya vamos para las sesiones plenarias, les voy a dar información útil. La sesión de biodiversidad, recursos naturales y desarrollo vinculando la ciencia y las nuevas tecnologías a los sectores primarios y agroindustriales se va a realizar en esta parte de atrás del salón. O sea, en este salón en 10 minutos va a estar partido a la mitad y allá va a ser esa sesión que es la paralela número 5. La sesión paralela número 6, que es vinculando la ciencia, la tecnología y la innovación, creación de valor a partir de conocimiento, va a ser en esta parte. En el Salón Diamante, aquí a mi derecha, es donde está la teleconferencia con Roma. Y la sesión número 7, de innovación social, generando y aplicando conocimiento para lograr objetivos sociales, va a estar en la parte izquierda mía, es decir, saliendo del salón a mano izquierda. Entonces los invitamos a que estén ahí, los conferencistas. Cada salón tiene un anfitrión logístico con el que pueden concertar y cuadrar que sus presentaciones funcionen muy bien. Y como les digo, pues ahí ya ustedes van a estar hasta las 12:30 del día en esas conferencias y a las 2 de la tarde en punto vamos a arrancar aquí. Como les reitero, les recomendamos por instrucciones de seguridad de la presidencia no traer objetos cortopunzantes en las carteras, sombrillas, maletines de viaje no van a dejar ingresar al salón, todo el mundo con su cédula. Y los esperábamos aquí faltando 5 minutos, 10 minutos para las 2 de la tarde para arrancar muy puntuales entonces esas sesiones y que podamos terminar el día muy bien. Entonces muchas gracias. Afuera hay un café.